rejoicing in the fact we're able to get together and worship you freely. Have your way in this service. Move up and down every aisle. Bless those watching by internet, Father. Lives would truly be changed by what they hear from you this morning. We give you all the praise and honor in Jesus' name. Soles of our feet, nothing missing, nothing broken in every area.
restoration, peace, comfort, joy, strength comes from you. And we love you, Father.
My heart wanna sing.
I can sing.
troubled times. Sing when I win, I can sing when I lose my spell and I fall down again. I can sing 'cause you pick me up, sing 'cause you're there.
This morning, those that are here, those that are watching by the internet, Lord God, move up and down every row and every aisle this morning and across phones, tablets, computers this morning. And we thank you and we give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's give God a good hand clap this morning. Amen. Oh, that was pretty good. Let's give him another good one. Amen. Praise God. Glory. Hey, I'm happy to be in church this morning because I am loved by the King. And if you're going through troubled times, he's right there with you. Amen. Bible says he'd never leave us nor forsake us. Amen. Do we have any first-time guests with us this morning? We'd like to welcome you, acknowledge you, and welcome you to the house of the Lord this morning. Just simply raise your hand, and raise it towards these ushers. They'll be happy to get you a connection card in front of you. Praise the Lord. Well, give yourself a good hand clap for making the church house this morning. Amen. If you're watching by the internet, give yourself a good hand clap, too, for tuning in. Amen. Amen. Well, go ahead and look to your left, to your right, and give somebody a virtual hug this morning. And husbands and wives, it's safe. This is a safe time to give your bride a hug as well. Amen. You may be seated in the name of the Lord this morning. Do we have any cheerful givers this morning? Amen. Thank you, Jackery. Do we have any cheerful givers this morning? Praise Amen. God. Amen. They're ready, Pastor. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Well, let's just ask another question. The cheerful giving one didn't get very much applause and claps. So do we just have anybody cheerful? Amen. Do we have anybody that needs to be cheerful? All right. Do we have anybody that's just downright ugly and mean this morning? Just see if, you know, someone say, what do you mean? Well, you know, you got to ask. But turn to 2 Corinthians 9 and let's talk about that cheerful giver that Pastor Renee's talking about. I want to thank you for being here. I realize that the weather is just not cooperating, but I got some great news for you. Listen to you. The sun is out. The sun is shining. It's beautiful. There's just clouds obscuring our view. So we have to see beyond that and look at where the Lord is. And it's somewhere, it's beautiful. Someone said, yeah, but we're not somewhere. I realize that, but you know, you got to keep a positive aspect on everything. Look at 2 Corinthians, the 9th chapter. Look at verse 6. But this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And then he says, and he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. But you can't stop there. Look what he goes on to say. And God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you always, having all sufficiency in all things, may have an abundance for harvest. God wants you to receive it. Why? For an abundance of good work. And I'm going to, before we read, let's read, and then I want to say this. Then he goes on to say, as it is written, he has dispersed abroad, he has given to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. Now may he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food supply and multiply the seed you have sown and increase the fruits of your righteousness. Do a study on the fruits of righteousness sometimes. One of the main ingredients you'll see always is peace. The peace of God. So in your giving, know there's peace. And talk about disperse to the poor. I got some great news for you. I was talking to my brother the other day on the phone and told him that what our teams do. And he just was, for the lack of a better way, almost blown away with it. But on Saturday, Casey and Joe and Marty, Kathleen, some of you, Terry, y'all went out and ministered to the over 100 people were fed and had clothing and prayed for and ministered. And then this morning, 130 other people were ministered to by Gina and her team and some of you. So that's 230 people a week minimum that's being ministered to. Glory to God. Now, as someone said, why are you telling this? Because you are part of that. You that sow and you that give, you are a part of that. It's not just giving your time. When you sow finances, then things can happen. And this is a time of pandemic. Do you imagine how great it's going to be when all of that is lifted off and all of that's gone, and how much we'll be able to minister and help people? I'm excited about it. Put your offering in your hand. Let's be obedient to the Lord. Father, we thank you that you said that you supply seed to the sower. And you bless the people here. There are people that went into this pandemic with an uncertainty, but one thing they were certain about, their trust is in you. They have faith in you. And they've come out of this, Father, in all the circumstances, better than they went into it. Only you can get glory for that. Only you can get credit for that. So, Father, as we sow our seed, we know you've supplied the seed, but you also supply bread. So that means a harvest, a return. So we thank you for a harvest, a return on our giving, on our tithes, on our offerings, on our first fruit, on our alms and seed. We thank you for a harvest and a return for every good work in Jesus' precious name. And everyone agrees? Amen. Ushers, minister to the people. Brother Gary, thank you.
Continue to lift our voice to the Lord this morning.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Glory to God. Let's give a hand to Derek on the bass there, and playing and ripping it out there and singing. Thank you. I mean, glory to God. I mean, the man can sing. The man can play. The man knows Greek, Hebrew, the word. He can dance. The only thing I have against him, he's not a Marine. He's from the Army. But is it the 82nd Airborne? Was it? Woo! The man, a hero. And I appreciate him stepping up and doing it. My gosh, man, I'll tell you what. In my mind and in my spirit, that's how I could play. If I was playing, that's how I could play. I listened to Brother Copeland. That's how I could sing if I'd sing. Amen. Did you give virtual hugs to everybody? I know Pastor Ray. Turn around and do it again. And let everybody know you love them. You're glad they're here. And you can be seated. Glory to God. I saved some of the announcements and have Pastor Renee do them, but let me call you to prayer. I need you to pray for some families in our church. I had you last Sunday pray for Leonard Bumps and for Dean and be lifting them up. Well, Dean's doing better, and his oxygen levels are going up, and he's doing really good, and so we got to pray for him to get out of that hospital. Leonard Bumps is doing really good. He graduated and went to be with the Lord Tuesday. And he is doing fine. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So pray for Susie and the family. Leonard is a day warner here. Every single service and things like that, other than when he's working, he's been a part. So he graduated on Tuesday afternoon. Please be lifting him up. I also need you to lift up Annette Freeling, because James Freeling passed away Friday and went to be with the Lord. Most of you know James and Annette, and he passed away. So that's two in this week that heaven was increased and the earth suffered loss. And I'm saddened at it, but I'm also rejoicing with the family and lifting up. So keep Susie and Bumps, Annette Freeling and the family and Bumps, family in prayer. And then continue to rejoice for Dean and health and healing. And if you don't see somebody here, or you know someone that is storing up healing and needs to be made well and whole, please keep them in prayer. Let us know so we can keep them on the prayer list. We need to understand that there are people around us that need our prayers for comfort. They need strength. Not just feeding and clothing and ministering to, as Gina and everybody does. We have people here that need spiritual comfort and spiritual. So don't forget to lift one another up in prayer. Amen. In fact, I'll go ahead and make this statement before I get into today's message. The highest form of humility there is prayer. Because when you pray, you're basically saying, I need help. And you know who's going to help you, the Lord. So prayer is the highest form of healing. Just like thanksgiving for that which you don't have yet is the highest form of faith, the highest form of humility is prayer. So pray you one for another that you may be healed. Amen. Now, I had some things. I'll just go ahead and tell you this so you'll know it. Get your Bibles and turn to 2 Timothy 3. And we're going to continue on talking about it. And I'm going to tell you what, I'll just say this. I have never seen a time in my lifetime and in time like it is right now in the body of Christ and the earth that fits Scripture like 2 Timothy 3 is right now. Everything that's in there, man, you don't even have to turn the TV on. You can just walk around and see and know what's happening, that it is the last days. It is the end time. And I made some statements. I'm going to go ahead and save you some time. If you are wondering still about the election, still about those things, still about COVID and all that, Pastor George Pearson's did an Instagram, and we posted that on our website. Why would I try to say it again? I can't say it any better. Go out there to our website or to our Facebook page for Current Christian Center or KCC Live or Shelby and I, and click on that link, and Pastor George explains it. Very simple. We have a scripture that describes the election, describes the COVID, describes where you and I live. It's Mark 11:22. Have faith in God. Period. That's it. Answers it all. Amen. So if anybody says, well, what does Pastor say about this? Have faith in God. Amen. So that we got your answer. So someone said, well, why do people have trouble with that? I don't understand. I don't know why people think. Have you noticed right here in church, I don't understand why all of the people here are not Dallas Cowboy fans. I just can't even comprehend that. I mean, the Star of David, the Star of Dallas, that God's into stars. And but you know what we don't do? We have fun about it, and we don't let it divide us. So if you're here and you're a Democrat, a Republican, independent, or you're nothing when it comes to politics, we can have our views, but we don't ever let them divide us. Amen? We all have views. Different views don't make one wrong and one right. Different views mean you just approach things from a different direction. Not necessarily, well, I'm right and they're wrong, or they're right and I'm wrong. No, you both have different opinions and different views from different angles. Just don't let them divide you. Amen? So if you see somebody that says something or tries to bring something up like that, say, stop it, get in church. Have faith in God. Amen? Turn to 2 Timothy 3. I want to continue on. We've been talking about in 2021, Brother Copeland has said it's the year of the local church. And Brother Savelle said it's the year of abundant overflow. So it is the year that the local church will have abundant overflow. But personally, what I sought the Lord for, and He's given us as our mandate for this year, He's given us as our guideline, is in 1 Samuel 38. It says to pursue, overtake, and recover all. So this is our year to pursue the things of God, overtake them with, we pursue with the intent of catching, not just chasing, and we catch them, and then we recover all, and that word recover means restore, but better than it was before. Everybody, the word restoration doesn't just mean put it back where it was. When you restore a car, a lot of times, with the new technology and the new things you restored, it's better than it was before. Because of the different ways of doing things. I know when the Corvettes came out and the fiberglass came out and all the different things, and they tried to fix them and all like that. Well, how many of you realize now you can fix them much easier because you can buy that thing already molded, already done? You don't have to slap on the epoxy, slap on the fiberglass, sand it. It's already made better because of it, but it's still a Corvette. Now, our Bible doesn't need to be made better. You can't get better. It's settled. It's done. It's there. So look at 2 Timothy 3. And I want us to look at this. And we're taking this from a positive note. Instead of the word, we're looking at the antonym. We're looking at the reciprocal of what it would be. So look at 2 Timothy 3, verse 2. We know this is talking about perilous times. The word perilous there means something fierce enough to draw away your strength. The whole purpose of everything you see going on is to weaken you and I. The whole purpose of what we see going on is to weaken the church. That is the devil's main goal. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus said, I'm come that you'd have life and have it more abundantly. Amen? Let's pray. You're quiet. Now, let's do this. You pray for me, I'll pray for you. I'm going to pray for you to get a dance in your step. Get a lean in your walk, or if you drive, you know. I was telling James when I was telling you last week about his car with the B on the back. Beth let me know going out that B on the back stands for Beth. But I noticed that Beth's not driving it. James is. So he's the more than conqueror. But I told him to lean. You and I, as believers, no matter what you're going through, we have a greater hope. We have an answer. We have a place of expectation and faith that the world's looking for. And we should have a different walk. Pastor Renee spilled some coffee on him before the service came out. And a while ago over there, he said, some of that went on my shoe. My foot's kind of did me this. If you saw us laughing, we weren't laughing at worst break. We were laughing because that's just funny. So I'm going to pour some coffee on your shoes. Get to a little dance in your step. Look at 2 Timothy 3. Let's go to verse 2. men, here's why perilous times were coming, and their design is to weaken you. Men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, and unholy. Let's pray. You pray for me. I'm going to pray for you, and then we'll get into this. Father, we thank you for the word. We thank you for today. It's a day you've made, a day to rejoice and be glad in, a day to enter your courts with thanksgiving and praise, a day to worship you, to glorify you, to give gratitude and thanksgiving to you for all you're doing, all you've done, and all we know you're going to do in your word. So we thank you for it. We thank you for soundness and wholeness and healing. We thank you we're blessed going in and coming out, blessed in the church, blessed in home, blessed in the city, blessed in the field. Father, we're just blessed, and we receive that blessing now because you are a good God. So I thank you for the prayers of the people. I thank you that they hear and receive my prayers. We'll search your word. We'll receive your word. We'll be inspired by your word, but we'll be instructed and directed by your word because you gave it for that purpose, and we thank you for it. We praise you for it in Jesus' precious name. And everyone agrees? Amen. Now look at this again. We talked about in this the pursuit of not being a lover of yourself or themselves. That was the pursuit of selflessness. And then the pursuit of not loving of money, but being the opposite of lovers of money is not being not greedy or unselfish. The actual opposite is contentment. Not content with just being down, but content with the fact that you know the word's true, the word works, and it will direct you out and direct you in a way the footsteps of a righteous man or woman are ordered of the Lord. And so you have a pursuit of contentment. And then we saw on Wednesday night the pursuit of what and who's real. If there's ever a time everybody's saying get real, when everything they see doesn't seem to be real. And everything they're portraying is not real. So we need to pursue what is real. But now I want you to notice what's on there and followed is the word proud. Now, I know people, and you know people, that are so humble they're proud of it. And that's not true humility. That's false humility. I know people that will tell me, say, well, I'll tell you what, I'm not this or this or this or this, and boy, I'm proud of it. I wouldn't do this or I wouldn't do that like they did that, and I'd never do that, and I'm proud of that. Well, you wouldn't do that, but now you've got to deal with that pride. And one of the end time things, have you noticed, let me give you a for instance, have you noticed on television, everybody is an expert. Everybody's an expert. I mean, climate change. Everybody's an expert. I mean, they don't even have to go to school. They're trying to get them experts in elementary school. And you'll have elementary school people telling adults what climate change is. Listen, I'm going to save you some trouble. We have had climate change since the earth was created. It's called fall, spring, winter, summer. We've had periods of really dry weather, we've had periods of hot weather, we've had periods of cold weather, and climate change is real. You can't deny climate change, but the problem is when you make it a religion and your desire is to control people, and you are trying to present yourself as being humble because you're trying to make a change when you think everybody else isn't, that's pride. And expert. I tell you, you turn the TV on, it's one. I mean, if you're a newscaster, your degree's in journalism, not science, not biology, not medical doctor. They took 12 years to be that, but yet you're an expert on it. I want to tell you something right now. I'm going to save some of you some trouble. I am not an expert on the Word of God. Just going to tell you that, because the more that you learn in the Word, the more God increases your ability to learn and know in the Word. So in essence, the more you know, the less you know, because He's increased your ability to know. So you never get into pride and arrogancy and say, well, I got it all right and I got it there. Listen, we're all learning and doing the best and preaching it as we see it. But we need to understand this expert mentality is pride. And it I'm not saying you shouldn't be an expert in your field. You shouldn't be. If I had to have surgery, and I won't, I'm going to tell you what, I want the best in that field I can get. Amen. But if a reporter was for reporting on a surgery, I wouldn't tell the reporter, well, you go ahead, you told me you're an expert on it, go ahead and do the surgery. No, but I'm on to this because I want you to catch something. Pride sneaks up on you. The reason it sneaks up on you is it's based in deception. The basis of all pride or proud there is deception. Now, if you look the word proud up, it means haughty, arrogant, an inflated view of yourself and or your abilities. An inflated view. Now, keep what I said in mind there. An inflated. It means to be high-minded. So if you see the word arrogant, you see the word proud, you see the word high-minded, it's all talking about pride. It's all talking about that literal haughtiness that people can get if you don't watch out. So turn to 1 Timothy 6 and let me show you something. We just talked about being selfless. We just talked about not being greedy and literally being in content. Not that you don't push for, strive for, and desire more, even in the realm of finances. But it tells you now that you don't become a boaster. You get real about it, and you've got to guard against pride. So look at 1 Timothy 6:17. You remember all the scriptures we read in the past sessions about lovers of money? It says here, "For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, and therewith have people been drawn away from the faith." It didn't say money was the root of all evil. It says the love of money causes different kinds of evil, and their desire is to draw you away from trusting God and from faith. So with that in mind, look at verse 17 that Paul writing to Timothy said, "Charge them that are rich in this world that they be not high-minded." High-minded, arrogant, haughty. Now, if you're here and you're saying, "Now, boy, I'll tell you what, I don't even have to be concerned about that. That's not me. I am not rich." Listen to me carefully. It's not whether you have or don't have. It's the attitude of your heart. And I know some people that are haughty, arrogant, and prideful that don't have a dime. I know some people greedy and love money that don't have a dime. I also know more that have it that are that way, whatever. But you can be blessed. You can be prosperous. You can be financially, successful. And I'm praying for you to be that way. But there's an attitude of heart that we have to keep here. So listen to 1 Timothy 6:17 again. "Charge them that are rich in this world that they be not high-minded, nor trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God, who giveth us richly all things to enjoy." Notice that "gives us richly all things to enjoy." The whole purpose there is that you should be blessed to where you'll have to be able to enjoy. But what you can't do is get haughty and high-minded into pride, and you can't trust in the riches. You have to trust in the living God. Listen to the New King James there. "Command those who are rich in this present age not to be haughty, nor to trust and earn certain riches, but in the living God, who gives us richly all things to enjoy." But I like the Amplified here. Look at 1 Timothy 6:17. Let me read it to you in the Amplified. "As for the rich in this world, charge them not to be proud and arrogant and contemptuous of others." That's high-minded, haughty. "Nor to set their hopes on uncertain riches, but on God, who richly and ceaselessly provides us with everything for our enjoyment." Now, did you notice that that would have been a real good time for Paul to say, based on some theology and some experts out there, that charge those that are rich in this world to give it all away. Charge those that are rich in this world to give it to the poor. He didn't say that. This would have been a good time to deal with it because he's talking about lovers of money and those that who set their love on money. He didn't. He said, charge those that are rich that they don't get into pride. They don't get arrogant. They don't get haughty. They don't get contemptuous of others. So it didn't say that you have to give it all away or that you couldn't be successful or prosper. Religion has brought that in. People that have taught based on what their experience is and think that is the expert view of it have said that. It doesn't say that. That would have been a good time. It just says don't be prideful, high-minded, haughty, proud, arrogant, and contemptuous. So we see here, the teaching here is not, watch this, 1 Timothy 6, 2 Timothy 1, 2, and 3. The teaching here is not about you having or not having, for because my God supplies all of my need according to His riches in glory. God will meet that need. He said He will. He'll supply that need, and He'll strengthen us because I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. Paul wrote to the Philippian church, and we put it in here. The whole thing that Timothy is writing about is the pride or the proudness of heart that you have to guard against. All of it. So right here, the pursuit that we're going to pursue is the pursuit of humility. And being poor isn't humility. Now watch this. Putting yourself down and talking down about yourself doesn't humble you either. Not Bible. That's not what true humility is. I know some people, I'm just so very humble. Very humble doesn't mean that you just put yourself down and make yourself of less value. You're valuable to God. That's, in fact, that can be a false humility that deceives you into think you're humble and you're actually being ran over by the devil because he's got you in a form of pride that is not talked about a lot. Maybe we'll talk about it in this. So we're going to pursue humility here for a while. We're going to talk about being humble in this area. So turn over to Romans, the 12th chapter. The pursuit of humility. We know what pride is, haughty, high-minded, arrogant, an inflated opinion and view of ourselves and our abilities. But let's talk about humility and what it actually biblically means. But look at Romans 12, 16. He says, be of the same mind toward one another. Do not set your mind on high things, but associate with the humble. Do not be wise in your own opinion. Now, on the surface, if you read that, you can glance over that and miss something. Listen to the New Living Translation there. Live in harmony with each other. Don't be too proud to enjoy the company of ordinary people. And don't think you know it all. We're starting to see, and I'm hoping I'm painting a picture to you of where I'm going with this. So pride is high-minded. High and a lofty estimation of oneself and your abilities. Humility, if you look at the Bible and look at the Greek, means to be lowly in heart. Lowly in heart. Not in finances, not in stature, not in health, not in soundness of mind. It's to be lowly in heart. It means gentleness, meekness, mildness. These are all attributes of a humble heart, one that's there. Now, I want to make a statement here. You have to humble yourself. Well, no, I heard someone the other day say it, and it went off in me, and I was wanting to bring it up, but the gist of what they were saying is COVID-19 has really humbled a lot of people. No, COVID-19 has tried to destroy, kill, and rob and steal a lot of people. But you don't get humbled by what others are doing to you. That's called humiliation, not humbling. You humble yourself. And the only promise you have in the Word, we'll look at it, if not today, we'll look at it another time, is your job is to humble yourself. But to humble yourself doesn't mean to put yourself down. It doesn't mean to make yourself So that's not humbling yourself. Humbling yourself is letting your heart be of a mild, meek, gentle heart. But it doesn't mean you don't be strong, that you're weak. Jesus was the most humblest of person and people I know, but he was not weak. He was the strongest people we know, but he was humble. Why? Because of his heart. What's there? So the two most deadly things, and where I want to go with this, and I'm just going to set a foundation, and then we'll talk more about it on Wednesday, and I need you to not be too proud to come. Ooh, got quiet. Anyway, thank you for the two amens at the back as they're going out the door. No, I'm just teasing. Two things that pride does and where it came in here. These two deadly things came through the flesh. They are products of the flesh. Satan introduced these things into the flesh realm, and that is selfishness and pride. Those two things have destroyed more believers than just about anything that exists. Someone said, no, I know some people, they got well off and they left the church of God. No, if that's the case, then they forgot to humble themselves and to be selfless. Not the stuff, not the blessing, it was what they did with it. The most deadliest things that you and I have to face and have to fight and are supposed to overcome is selfishness and pride. And it's probably two things that's taught on the least in some circles, because you have to teach it in a positive note. You don't need to beat people up. You need to show them selflessness. You don't need to just beat people down and think that's humbling them. You need to show them what true humility is. Not humiliation, humility. Other people, other things, other circumstances do not, will not, and are not humbling you. You have to humble yourself. Those other things will humiliate. Other people will try to humiliate, but you don't have to let them. You can make a decision. I'm not going to be humiliated. Now, there is a flip side. Maybe we'll get to that scripture. If you exalt yourself, those who exalt themselves will be humbled. But it doesn't mean others do it. The word, I'll show you in Corinthians, says that Paul said, I exalted and then the Lord humbled me. So if you exalt yourself, God will humble you. If you'll exalt him, then he will exalt you. And so the only humility or humbling that you and I do is what we do to ourselves and what God does, because we don't do it to ourselves. Now, I know people say, well, God won't humble you. Well, you got a scripture you got to deal with. And I'll get into it in a minute. So I want us to look at selfishness and pride and its origin, and look where it came from. Show you why when you turn the TV on and you start looking. In fact, I'm praying that as you look out at the things going on, the television, the media, the news, the things around it, all these things going on, I'm hoping that your little spiritual antennas are going up, or your big spiritual antennas are going up, and you're picking up on this, because a lot of what's driving everything going on right now is what 2 Timothy 3 is talking about. I mean, it's selfishness, it's greed, it's loving of money, it's boasters, it's pride, and all of those have their birth in the father of pride, the father of selfishness, which is the devil. You have to understand that. He started it in the garden and he kept it on. So let's look at that for a minute. If we understand the source of it, it's not that person. It's not that position. It's the one behind it that's driving that. There's where our battle is. This is a spiritual battle, not a physical battle. It's a spiritual battle. And we have to deal with that. Turn over to Isaiah 14. Let me show you something. Pride, being proud, ungodly pride is from Satan. He's the father of selfishness and he's the father of pride. So let me show you something. Turn to Isaiah 14 verse 12. Let's look at the source of it. Let's go back to the very... You remember Jesus told them, you're of your father the devil, because he's the father of lies. So you know right there all lying came from that. So, but we're talking about pride. And look at Isaiah 14 12. Well, actually we're talking about humility. But look at Isaiah 14, verse 12. How you are fallen from heaven, O Lucifer. So you know right there, it's talking about the devil. Lucifer was Lucifer until he was cast out and cast down. Then he became Satan. So he was at first Lucifer. Now look what it goes on to say. Son of the morning, how you are cut down to the ground, you who weaken the nations. Now here's how he weakened. Now remember 2 Timothy 3, in the last days perilous times will come. In the last day, things will come to weaken and to sap your strength, is what perilous means. And these are the things going on. But look at their source and where they came from. He said, for you have said in your heart, now, and by the way, look up here at me before we go. These are called the five eyes of pride. You know, pride, the middle letter is I. So that answers most of it. But five eyes. Look at this, at what he says. For you said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation on the far sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet, those five eyes of pride there, yet, he says, you shall be brought down to Sheol, to the lowest depths of the pit. The five eyes of pride, all of those in Lucifer's heart. Now, let me make a statement, and I want to clear. There is a scripture that says God created the waster to destroy. So God didn't create Satan to do these things. God didn't create Satan to kill, steal, and destroy. God didn't create him that way. He created Lucifer, not Satan. So turn over to Ezekiel 28. Let's look at how it came to pass. God created him, but he created him Lucifer. He didn't create him Satan. Satan came into being because of his pride. And because of that, he was cast down. His pride. So he's the father of it. Look at Ezekiel 28:14. A few years ago, I taught on this, and I'm going to bring a bunch of it in different things, because right now, though, it's time for this, for us to understand the things that are weakening us, understand the enemy's, his whole, with news, used to be it took a long time to get the news about something because we didn't have social media and instant everything. But now that it's instant, you have to realize you have the opportunity to be instantly attacked or instantly drained. So you got to build yourself up now. You got to edify yourself now. You got to get strong in this now. So look at Ezekiel 28:14. I ordained and anointed you as the mighty, and I'm reading out of the New Living Translation for time, if you would. I don't want to read both of them and take that time. Listen, you read along in whatever translation you have. This is the New Living Translation. I ordained and anointed you as the mighty angelic guardian. You had access to the holy mountain of God, walked among the stones of fire. You were blameless in all you did from the day you were created. He was created blameless. He was created as the anointed guardian, the anointed cherub. And we know later in Scripture, he led to worship and praise. And he was Jesus's personal, like Michael and Gabriel have different aspects. He was a personal angelic guardian to the Lord. That's why the Lord was the one that was sent to take care of him and to redeem back what he had stolen from mankind. But watch this. He says, from the day you were created until you were perfect in the day you were created until the day evil was found in you. So he was not created as the destroyer. He was created as Lucifer, the angelic guardian. But because of pride, evil came in. And that pride and selfish ambitions, there is all evil and every confusion, Peter said. So look at this, what this goes on. He said, your rich commerce led you to violence, and you sinned. So I banished you in disgrace from the mountain of God. I expelled you, O mighty garden, from your place among the stones of fire. Your heart was filled with pride because of all your beauty. Your wisdom was corrupted by your love of splendor. Remember the things we're talking about? Selfishness, pride, boasting, love of money, all of this commerce and the things he's talking about is that very thing. Your heart was filled with pride because of all your beauty. Your wisdom was corrupted by your love of spending. So I threw you to the ground and exposed you to the curious gaze of kings. Satan's pride, his love of himself, his love of money, his I will exalt myself. How many of you realize that you and I are the creation, and no matter how wonderful we get, we are never going to be better than the Creator? It's just not going to happen. Everybody with me on that? So Satan's pride caused him to be cast out and cast down. So when you see this, I want you to catch something here. And this is where I want to go, and we see it played out around us like supernaturally fast, it seems like. That's why I'm saying it's so spiritual. But in this, I want you to notice something. Pride in your heart. Always. Everybody say always.
Always.
Now let me tell you what you're always in. Pride in your heart always involves lies. See how quiet that one got? Pride always has as involved in it and as a basis lies. Satan had pride in his heart. Why did he have pride in his heart? It involved the lie. I will exalt my throne. I will ascend into that. I will be like the Most High God. He started in pride into lies and deception. So pride in someone's heart will deceive you. Turn to Obadiah 1. Let me show you this. Obadiah, back where your pages stick together. Go to Malachi and go back a few. Obadiah. Look at 1 verse 3. Now this is talking about Belshazzar, and not like Nebuchadnezzar, but in this I want you to notice something that the Lord's showing you and I in this. Obadiah 1:3. The pride of your heart has deceived you. Pride always involves deception, and deception is a lie. So pride always involves a lie. And someone said, what do you mean? It involves believing a lie. You're either lying to yourself, and eventually you'll lie to others. Now look at this. The pride of your heart has deceived you. You who dwell in the clefts of the rock, whose habitation is high, you who say in your heart, who will bring me down to the ground? When you are in pride, you're in deception. And when you're deceived, you're lied to. And you're either lying to yourself or you're lying to others. That's what pride does. Look at the person next to you and say, you're not proudful. Turn to the one on the other side and say that. Now, that's a whole lot more edifying than if I'd have told you to turn to the person next to you and say, you're a liar. Now, that wouldn't have been very good, was it? And that's not you. But a person that's in pride is self-deceived and lying either to themselves or others or both. But all pride has in its foundation deception in the heart. All right, now watch this. This is going to be real simple. Humility is when you are honest and truthful in your own heart. Has nothing to do with stuff, money, success or not, or COVID, or presidents, or political parties, or governors, or any. It has nothing to do with that. It has everything to do with your heart. What is the attitude of your heart? Are you proudful in your heart? Well, I'm a believer and I'm proud of it. I'm not talking about having pride in your children. I'm not talking about having pride in your church. I'm not talking about having pride in your accomplishments. You can be proud of your children, proud of those things, but you need to understand that pride that gets out of control is because when it's not true anymore and it becomes a lie. People are in pride, and it's a lie. Everybody with me? So I'm not talking about you being proud of your children, proud of your husband, proud of your wife. We all want to make and do our families proud. proud. I'm talking about an attitude of heart that lies to yourself and in turn lies to others. Now, I know somebody's thinking, but this, I don't like this. Or I'd rather you say I don't like this than you just say, well, I sure don't need this. Okay, moving along. Some of you got it. Now, let me throw something in here, though. Humility, Bible humility, in the pursuit of humility, humility is not you running yourself down. It's not you making light of your gifts and abilities. It's not you putting yourself down. And it's not you denying recognition for a job well done. Everybody with me on that? If you do a good job and somebody tells you, good job, well, what, you don't go, oh, no, oh, no, no, no. That's not humility. That's false humility. How about, well, thank you. Without the Lord, I couldn't do anything. And I mean, I had to get through this. I mean, you people used to come up to me, that was the best message I have ever heard. I'm supposed to stay up here. Okay. They're watching. See, I'm praying for them to turn on the internet and watch. And they may think they're checking on us. But I think they're hearing the word. Anyway. That's you start thinking, well, and I used to tell, oh, no, I can take no credit. I can take no credit. And the Lord told me one time when I was talking and studying about humility, he said, that's false humility. And I said, why is that? And he said, well, you studied, you prepared, you've given your life to putting these together. You let me speak to you how to do it. So stop being in false humility and just say, thank you. It's the Lord that gives us the word, and go from there. He said, how about stop denying any kind of approval or any kind of thank you when it's good? That's not humility. That's false humility, because in your heart or in my heart, you want to go, yeah, thank you. See, now that's when it gets into a problem. So when you think you deserve recognition is when pride can get in. But when you get recognition, to deny it is false humility. If somebody wants to brag on you, let them brag on you. Your problem is when you start bragging on yourself. And the other problem, if it's not true and you believe a lie. Okay, moving along. This is such a good subject. Amen. But here's the key. Here's the key. Most believers think humility is hungry, starving, doing without, not having, putting themselves down, never letting anybody build them up, never letting anybody encourage them or edify. What do you think the word edify means? To build up. And they build up by good. They don't build up by beating down. But we get a false humility here, and you don't have to look down at yourself, nor do you need to speak down. Hey, listen, let me give you pastoral secret. Tell me you won't tell anybody. It's going to be just for you that are here or that are watching on the internet. Listen, you don't have to put yourself down. There are people that feel anointed to do it. You know, everybody understand what I'm talking about? You don't have to speak down about yourself. My God, I don't have to run myself down for the shortcomings as a pastor. There's plenty in town that feel like they're anointed to do it. But how many of you realize that didn't make it true? Even if they think it's true, it doesn't make it true. There are people that believe Darwinism. They believe you and I came from an amoeba. That the big blast took place, and there was little water molecules, and they were in that, and then all the water molecules got together, and then all the little amoebas that came into those little water molecules started together, and then they started getting together, and they formed a little, a big amoeba, I guess, and then it grew legs, and there are fins and gills, and then it grew legs, and then it crawled out of the water, then it learned to breathe out of the water, then it crawled into the trees, and then it got out of the trees and become us. There's no proof of that in any way, shape, or form. It's a theory. But there are people that believe it with all of their heart because of a lack of knowledge. Those same people will fight you over that. I've stopped fighting with people. Someone says, well, I believe in Darwinism. And I just say, okay, I was kind of had some concern about your roots anyway. Okay, moving along. And then I apologize and go from there. Humility is not putting yourself down. It's not running yourself down. Sometimes, if you don't build yourself up and encourage yourself in the Lord, there's not anybody else there to do it. And the Lord wants you, like David in 1 Samuel 30, we was talking, to you encourage yourself in the Lord. You have to encourage. You need to get up. And there's nothing wrong with you getting up and going, all right. It's a day the Lord's made. In Him I can do all things. In Him I'm healed and whole and prosperous and victorious. Glory to God. He chose me for this day and this hour and this time. And I'm not in pride, but glory to God. I want Him to use me and speak through me. To humble yourself is to make yourself mild, gentle, and meek in His presence. And He can use you. Not arrogant. Look at Romans 12:3. Let me give you a for instance here. Get back to the word. Humility is not speaking down about yourself and looking down on yourself. Look at Romans 12:3. And let me give you proof looking down on yourself and speaking down to yourself is not humility, because true humility builds you up. When you look down on yourself and put yourself down, that leads to depression. So the end result of it is not building, being built up. It's not humility. Look at Romans 12:3. For I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you. Now, everyone means all of them. Everybody who is among you. Not to think of himself or herself or themselves more highly than they ought to think. Now, look up here at me. That did not say not to think highly of yourself. It said you shouldn't think more highly than you should. It didn't say you couldn't have high respect for yourself. It shouldn't say you shouldn't expect great things from yourself. And not because of you, but because who lives in you. But that says not to think more highly of yourself than you ought. Than you ought means that you should not be putting yourself down. You should think highly of yourself. And like I just explained to you, if you don't, sometimes nobody else will. But that's where humbling yourself comes in and allowing God to be in true humility. But this says not to think more highly than you ought. Instead of just putting it in a negative realm, that means you should think highly of yourself. Because he goes on to say, think soberly as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. Listen to the Amplified right there. For by the grace, unmerited favor of God given to me, I warn everyone among you not to estimate and think of himself more highly than he ought, not to have an exaggerated opinion of his own importance. There's a big definition of pride, an exaggerated opinion of oneself or one's accomplishment. And Paul didn't say you shouldn't have a degree of exaltation for that, just not more highly than you ought, not an exaggerated view. And he said, but to rate his ability with sober judgment, each according to the degree of faith apportioned by him to God. More highly than you ought means you ought to think highly. I tell you, if there's anything I want to do in this day and hour, is I want to strengthen you. The way you strengthen you is the opposite of what that. I want you to pursue selflessness. And as you are selfless, it starts doing something to self. And I want you to pursue contentment. And then God can trust you with all those rich things to enjoy, because you won't love it and trust in it. You'll use it to establish every good work. You'll do the things that are needed. And there's nothing wrong with you being blessed because you've accomplished things and did things and applied yourself and the Lord's done it. And all of these things keep, though, not a high-mindedness and a haughtiness that is contemptuous towards others, but keep yourself humble. Keep yourself mild. Keep yourself meek, which is yielded strength. Keep yourself gentle. Everybody realize that? More highly, not an exaggerating opinion. If you say about yourself what's in Christ Jesus in you, that's not an exaggeration. If I say I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, that's not an exaggeration. That's the word. My God supplies all of my need according to His riches in glory. I am healed by the stripes of Jesus. I've made whole. I've been granted boldness to speak your word by you stretching forth your hand to show signs and wonders. That's not talking about me. That's what's talking about the Lord in me. And that's not exaggerated opinion. That's God's opinion of you and I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Religion and religiosity had a hard time with that when the charismatic movement started, and all of a sudden, 2 Corinthians 5:17, I'm a new creature, a new creation, and my righteousness is of Him, and in Him I've been made the righteous. When those things came out, they gagged and choked and stumbled over that, because how dare you say that? You know you're nothing but a sinner saved by grace. Yes, but when you got saved by grace, you weren't that sinner anymore. Now, that doesn't mean you don't have a propensity to sin if you don't bring the mind into renewal and put the flesh down. Because the flesh still wants to work in selfishness and pride and deceive you and do this. So you have to mortify the deeds, crucify it. Walk not in the fruits of the flesh, but in the fruits of the Spirit, and allow them to work. So if you're saying things that are not true, that are not word about yourself, you have to watch that, because you could get into arrogance, haughtiness. And boy, we see that played out. I've never seen people so wrong in what they're saying, but so arrogant, proudful, and haughty towards you and I if we just believe the truth and don't believe what they believe. You don't believe that? So find you a climate change enthusiast that worships at the altar of climate change, and just tell them that you believe God's in control, that you shouldn't think more highly of man. My hairspray, ladies, or the air conditioning in my car, the Freon, these things are not going to destroy the planet. God's going to, so if I was you person, I would get saved. That'll help you. That'll be climate change in your mind. It'll clear the fog away, the veil away, and allow you to see. So let me help you on this, okay? Can I help you with some things for just a second? All right, is it okay? I had 1, 2 amens. The rest of you get free help. You didn't even agree to it. It's all free. Let me tell you 4 things about you. I'm going to help you. I don't even have to know you intimately that much, which, well, I'm honored that we do know each other. But let me tell you, let me say it this way so that you won't think I'm haughty and high-minded, the thing I'm preaching. Let me give you 4 realities about us. Okay, you ready for this? 4 scriptures, 4 realities. Turn over to Galatians 6:3. Let me give you some real biblical truths about you and I. These will be your anchors to help you stay humble. Look at Galatians 6:3. For if anyone thinks himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. So the first thing I want to tell about you and I is, without Christ, you and I are nothing. Without Christ, we are nothing. Now that sounds cruel, but I just read you scripture. It says here, if anyone thinks him to be something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. And this is talking about Christ in us. So pride always leads to deceptions in lives. And that's why people that are not in Christ, that don't know Christ, think they're something when really they are nothing. So you and I, first reality, without Christ, we are nothing. Now, that didn't say we were not something in Christ, but without Him, we're nothing. Now, turn over to 1 Corinthians 8:2. 1 Corinthians 8:2. It says, and if anyone thinks that he knows anything, he knows nothing yet as he ought to know. So without Christ, we are nothing. And point number two, without Christ, we know nothing. Are you enjoying this? Don't leave, Anthony. I'll get better. He's going to the camera. So without Christ, we are nothing. Without Christ, we know nothing. You know what you know because of the mind of Christ and Christ and the Word. And that you, but without Christ, we don't know anything. Turn to 1 Corinthians 4:7. Let me give you number three. First Corinthians 4, verse 7. For who makes you differ from another? And what do you have that you did not receive? Now, if you did indeed receive it, why do you boast as if you had not received it? What you and I need to understand, number three, is without Christ, we have nothing. So, without Christ, we are nothing. Without Christ, we know nothing. Without Christ, we have nothing. And some of you are thinking, well, how could it get any worse than that? Turn over to John 15 and 5. See, that's where pride comes in and gets people into works versus grace. When you're into works, then you want to take credit for the works. That gets into pride and self-deception because without Christ, we have nothing. Now look at John 15 and 5. It's in red. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. Now, I don't know if you grabbed that or not, but let me go ahead and give you four realities about you and I. Without Christ, we are nothing. Without Christ, we know nothing. Without Christ, we have nothing. And without Christ, we can do nothing. Now, I don't know about you. I find nothing in there that opens the door for pride. When you come to that realization, then you've taken on what needs to be there to help get rid of haughtiness. How can you and I as believers, Christians, especially word, faith, spirit-filled, mountain-moving, tongue-talking believers operating in the gifts, how can we ever get prideful and arrogant without lying to ourselves and deceiving ourselves? Because without him, we know nothing. Without him, we are nothing. Without him, we can do nothing. And without him, we have nothing. So that means I need to make sure I'm not without him. But with him, I can think highly of myself because he's in me, but just not an exaggeration opinion of ourselves. So let's do a little sword drill right quick. All of these we'll talk about maybe Wednesday night, maybe not, and go into a different area, but we're talking about the pursuit of humility. Turn over to Proverbs 11:2. Stay in your Bible with me. Keep it open. We're going to stay there, and if you're taking notes, you can come back and get it online or whatever. Look at Proverbs 11:2. When pride comes, then comes shame, but with the humble is wisdom. Turn to Proverbs 15:25. This is one that ought to give you confidence if you're concerned about all of those people that are out there that are trying to suppress, oppress, deceive, and lie to you, that are arrogant and full of pride, high-minded, greedy, lovers of themselves. Look at Proverbs 15:25. The Lord will destroy the house of the proud, but he will establish the boundary of the widow. He will destroy the house of the proud. Now look at Proverbs 16:18. Most of you know this one. You've heard it your whole Christian walk. Pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. It may look like they're exalted, but they will be brought low because pride leads to destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. Now go to Proverbs 29:23. Proverbs 29:23. I don't have a lot more of these, but I want you to see some things in the Word. Look at Proverbs 29:23. A man's pride will bring him low, but the humble in spirit will retain honor. Will retain honor. Now, I want to make a statement here, and let me show you why I think proud is there. Proud is in Romans, the first chapter, and that we read on Wednesday night, where he's dealing with sexual immorality among those that don't retain or know God. They hate God. He talks about these things. Pride's listed through there. Pride's listed throughout the whole word. Pride is listed in Timothy when Paul's talking about being successful, gain, finances. Pride seems to be forefront in here, and it's a deception, a lying to yourself, and the father of it is the devil, Satan, who lied to himself and then tried to exalt himself, and he was brought low. And you and I are supposed to humble ourselves, and he will exalt us in due time. So it will happen. But one of the worst effects of pride, I want you to get this, if you get nothing else, but you're going to get it all. But let me say this, get this. The worst effect of pride is it hardens your mind and hardens, I don't know, let me say it this way. The worst effect of pride is it hardens your mind to where you're not able to understand. That's why people believe a lie and will fight you over it and go up and say and declare themselves expert about it, because their pride has hardened their mind to where they can't understand, because with the hardening of the mind comes the hardening of their understanding. Hardening means to callous, to cause it not able to get through. Turn over to Daniel 5. You remember when Daniel was talking, now this is when Daniel was talking about Belteshazzar as versus Nebuchadnezzar, not earlier, but look at Daniel 5:20. Let me show you what Daniel said because of the dreams and the interpretations and the things that were there. Look at Daniel 5:20. But when his heart was lifted up, that's pride. When his heart was lifted up, Daniel 5:20, and his mind hardened in pride, he was deposed from his kingly throne, and they took his glory from him. That scripture literally says, in some translation, hardening of his spirit, but the actual rendering in the Hebrew there is hardening of his mind. So pride puffs you up, makes you arrogant, and hardens your mind. And when your mind's hardened, you don't understand. Have anybody here ever, have you ever tried to talk to somebody that was proud and arrogant? To get them to understand their pride and they're proud and they're arrogant. They don't understand it. They think you're crazy. How dare you? You know who you are? Prideful people are hardened in their mind and they don't think they're proud. That's why it's so hard to get through to them, because they've hardened their mind. Prideful people never see their own pride, it seems like, because they're self-deceived. Amen? We all know, I know some people that are so proudful, but they'll fight you over the fact of how humble they are. And they're proud of their humility. But they're in pride and arrogancy. And remember now, pride's not putting yourself down. Pride is an exaggerated opinion that hardens your mind, hardens your thinking there. It puffs you up, makes you arrogant, makes you haughty, because the mind is hardened. That's why without the born-again experience of Christ recreating and making a brand new person, and then the revelation of the Word by the inspiration and an anointing of the Holy Spirit breaks through, plows up that fallow ground, then they can see and be able to know. The pride deceives them and keeps them from it. That's the tool that Satan is using in our day and hour. There are people that will tell you socialism is the only way to go. And they believe it. But it's the one thing that's failed in its every attempt all over the world. It's never worked, never will work, never going to work. Because just big government, you know, remember Plato's Republic? Plato's Republic was this. It wasn't a republic. It's called that. There was the government. There was a ruling class elite. There was the government that worked for the... And then there was the military class. And then there was the worker that was the worker bee that did it all. The military kept them working. The government took and made sure the military had what was there. And then the ruling class distributed to everybody down there only what they thought they ought to have, not what they've earned and they were working for. That's Plato's Republic. That is Karl Marx's theory for socialism. And there are people that will tell you it works. And it doesn't. Never has, never will. But they believe it will, and they're sincere in their believing it will because they have hardened their mind. Someone said, why do you believe it won't work? What's your basis? The Word. If it's not Christ-centered and God-centered, it's going to fail. If it's not Word-centered, it's going to fail. Everybody with me on that? So, turn to Psalm 138. I'll close with this one. Psalm 138, look at verse 6. The New King James says it this way. Though the Lord is on high, yet he regards the lowly, that means humble, but the proud he knows from afar. Now, in the King James reading of that, it kind of leaves a little thinking of what, listen to the New Living Translation of Psalm 138:6. Though the Lord is great, he cares for the humble, but he keeps his distance from the proud. Keeps his distance. I don't know about you. I need the Lord to draw near. I don't need him keeping his distance from me. Listen to the Good Word Translation. God's Word Translation. Even though the Lord is high above, he sees humble people close up, and he recognizes arrogant people from a distance. But you can't beat the Passion Translation. Listen to this. For though you are lofty and exalted, talking about God, you stoop to embrace the lowly, yet you keep your distance from those filled with pride. When you and I or anybody gets into pride, God doesn't draw near. In fact, he distances himself. Why do you think it's their minds hardened and their hearts are hardened and it's hard for them to hear? If they heard, they have to hear him far off. When you get into pride, it hardens you and your ability to hear because God's not near. This says when you're in pride, he sees you from afar. Now, I'm not saying that he doesn't in you. He will speak in you. If you're a believer into pride and he speaks in you, he's still in you, but it's so hard for you to hear. It seems like he is so distant because of the pride. He will always speak to you. He'll never leave you or forsake you. But it seems so far away when pride is there, when arrogance is there. I don't know about you, this day and hour, right now, I need the Lord closer to me than he's ever been. I need him more alive in me than he's ever been. I need him speaking to me like never before. And I have to shut out some of those voices out here, those experts that are out here, to let him just talk to me. Anybody else in that same situation? And you know why I say that? Because without him, I am nothing. Without him, I can do nothing. Without him, I have nothing. And without him, I know nothing. So I think I need him. And I need him in me in a special way. Amen? Did you get anything out of this? I'm going to stop right there. We'll pick it up again. Now, don't go out of here and put yourself down and think that's humility. That's just putting yourself down. And what, to your amazement, if you put yourself down, others will too. And you wonder why they do that. Well, because you did. But if you start exalting yourself above an exaggerated opinion, they will not exalt you. They'll turn around and put you down behind your back. So we need to learn to be humble. And we'll talk some more about this on Wednesday night. The pursuit of humility. This is the year for the church to humble itself before the mighty hand of God. Pray. And he said, I'll hear and I'll heal your land. I'll heal your nation. I'll heal your people. I don't know about you. We need that more than ever. Amen. Stand to your feet. Glory to God. I don't know if Pastor Renee's caffeine on his foot's wore off. If he's got a little kick, you'll know by now. I want you to know, again, pray for the Bumps family as Leonard graduated to heaven Tuesday. Pray for James Freeland's family, Annette, as James graduated. We talked to him on Thursday. And then Friday morning, he's in heaven. And so, you know, pray for the family. Pray for them. They know he's there. They know exactly what I'm telling you. But there's still this missing part that we need to comfort and strengthen them in. Amen. Glory to God. Say this with me. God loves you. We love you. Jesus is Lord, and love prevails over all. Amen. Don't forget those things. Pastor Renee, make some announcements. And safe, 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 safe. Listen, you wonder why I'm talking about masks and gloves and all like that. Safe. Stay safe in the Word. Stay safe in the anointing. Stay safe in your life. But please understand that there's a raging enemy out there that we have to get our prayer life and get taken care of and defeated. Now, he's already defeated by the stripes of Jesus. It's a curse of the law, so we know we're redeemed from the curse. So we need to get to reminding and putting our prayer into that. Amen. But in the meantime, protect yourself. I'm your pastor. I care for you. I don't like calls I got Tuesday and Friday. I don't want those. Everybody with me on that? Protect yourself, please. Pastor Renee.
Amen. Anyway. Let's give the Lord a good hand clap. Amen. Wow. I had some coffee spilled on my leg earlier, and I told Pastor it landed on my shoe before service. I said, so if you see my foot doing this, that means the caffeine kicked in. Amen. And praise God. Anyway, talking about prayer, tomorrow night prayer at 7 p.m. here on campus. We'll have prayer partners up front to pray with you. Sound like Barry White all of a sudden here, amen? And some of the younger people don't know who that is, but anyway, praise God. And then February the 2nd is we're going to start our Bible study, and it's going to be an exciting time, understanding the end times from hope, excitement, and the book is written by Dr. Bob Yandian. And the first 25 people that attend that class, you will receive a free book, but you have to be at R&D Leather at the class at 7 p.m. to receive the book. And it'd be nice if you stayed through the class as well. Amen. And so I got to make sure I threw that disclaimer out there. And then if you are the 26th on, we have extra books for you. And the price yet has yet been to be determined how much we're going to sell those yet. So, no, just teasing. We haven't decided what it's going to be. But anyway, we have ordered extra books. So they are expected this week. And I've been informed by the accounting department, that's my faith speaking, praise God, that keep an eye on your mail. The 2020 year-end giving statements have gone out. So if you don't get it within, let's say, the next 10 days, there might be a chance we don't have your updated address. And so it'll be out there circulating, but it has gone out. So keep an eye on your mail, and you'll get that, and you can use it for your taxes and all that good stuff as well. Amen? Praise God. Just really encouraged by all the things that God is doing in our campus and our church and with all the outreaches that are going on. And this, we're just barely starting to scratch the surface. So we got great things going on. Amen. Father, we just thank you this morning. We thank you for your word, and we thank you that we're doers of the word and not just hearers only. I thank you, Lord God. We thank you for what Jesus did for us on the cross of Calvary, and we can walk with that confidence. We can walk in that victory. And Lord, we thank you now that we'll be sensitive to those that are around us as we go to the marketplace, as we go back to our jobs and the activities that are before us, Lord. I thank you that you give us words to say, Lord God, that brings life to those that need to hear about the gospel of Jesus Christ. I thank you for each and one of us here that you've empowered us with that. And Lord, now with every head bowed, please, and nobody looking around, maybe you've never been saved, you've never been born again, and you say, Pastor Renee, I'd like to get saved, I'd like to get born again. If that's you, just simply raise your hand, wave it towards me, and I'd be honored to pray for you and introduce you to Jesus this morning. If you've never done that and you'd like to this morning, what a wonderful thing, a house full of believers. Praise God. Maybe you're watching by the internet, you've never made that decision. Bible says that today is the day of salvation. All you got to do is believe in your heart, confess with your mouth that Jesus died, and the Bible says you'll be born again. Actually, it says you'll be a new creature in Christ Jesus. Amen. So I thank you now. We leave with Psalms 91. We leave divinely protected, and we thank you, Lord God, and we give you all the praise in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. We love you. God bless you. We'll see you this week.